Now, you can look into a telescope and get this kind of design, or you can look into a microscope and get the same kind of design. I don't have time to go into this argument in any great detail, but let's just go back to you. In the womb at 11 weeks. We were all there at one point. Question, is this animal, mineral, vegetable, or human? It's human. In fact, let's go all the way back to when your mother and your father got together. Have you guys had this talk before? I see some young people in here, so I'll try and be discreet. When your mother and your father got together, your father sent the entire population of the United States, 300 million soldiers, toward your mother's egg. And then there was a race, and you won. Don't let anyone ever tell you you're not special. You beat out 300 million others. You have blown away anything Michael Phelps has done. Now, seeing some of you limp in here earlier makes it hard for me to believe you were the fastest soldier in the gene pool. But you were. Now, your soldier was 20 to 30 times smaller than a grain of salt, yet it contained the full 3 billion letter genetic code that helps make you you. Actually, it contained half of that, because the other half was contained in your mother's egg, which was about the size of a period at the end of a sentence. And when your soldier and your egg came together, a new 100% genetic human being was created. You know, you have not received any new genetic information from that point till right now. Your genetic information has just multiplied itself. In fact, a construction project of astonishing complexity began taking place. Cells began multiplying at a rate of about 4,000 cells per second. Brain cells began multiplying at a rate of 100,000 cells per second. For most of you, anyway. Some cells became brain cells. Other cells became heart cells. Other cells became lung cells. How did they know how to do this? Nobody knows. Some cells went so far across you to become what they needed to become that it would be equivalent to you today walking across the United States alone. And that construction project continues to this day. You just made 4 million new red blood cells. You just made another 4 million new red blood cells. You just made another 4 million new red blood cells. Knock it off! How do you know how to do this? I don't have enough faith to believe there's not intelligence behind there. Oh, by the way, back to you when you're in the womb. You know, there was only 4 things separating you from adulthood. Time, air, water, and food. Those are the same 4 things that separate a 2-year-old from adulthood. Does this have implications on the abortion issue? Yeah, I think it does. We don't kill the 2-year-old. Why do we kill the unborn child in the womb? Genetically, it's the same. Now, again, there's more in the book on this, but we've got to move on now to the moral argument. We're still in does God exist, but we're moving on to the moral argument. I had the opportunity about 3 years or so ago to go on a trip across Europe. We started in London. We wound up in Berlin. We did basically what the Allies did in World War II. Along the way, we stopped at the Buchenwald concentration camp in Weimar, Germany. In April of 1945, the Allies liberated the camp. They went through the front gate, which is still there. They looked to the right. They saw the crematorium off in the distance, which is still there. They got down to the crematorium. And then they looked into the courtyard attached to the crematorium, and this is what they saw. Brace yourself. Now, if there is no God, this is just a matter of opinion. And by the way, atheists admit this. Richard Dawkins admits it. Yeah, if there's no God, then there is no objective morality. I don't have enough faith to believe that this is just a matter of opinion. This is really objectively morally wrong. In order for it to be objectively morally wrong, there has to be an unchanging moral authority beyond humanity whose very nature establishes what is right, and any deviation from it would be wrong. You have to suppress the truth, your basic intuition that something like this is wrong, to say that atheism is true. In fact, if there is no God, then the Nazis were not wrong. I was at Michigan State not long ago, and during the Q&A, there were a couple atheists sitting over here, and we got into a conversation about morality, and I said to one of them, I said, well, you're an atheist. What standard do you have for morality? And he said, whatever the majority decides is morally right. And I said, are you telling me that if you lived in Nazi Germany and you decided that you were going to murder all undesirables, including Jews, homosexuals, gypsies, that that would be morally right? And he paused, he blushed, and he said, yes. And his atheist buddy sitting right next to him yelled, no! See, the first kid knew in his heart the answer was no, but in order to be consistent with his atheism, he had to say yes. But of course, on atheism, the majority doesn't get to, nobody, there is no objective morality. Whoever has the most power just decides whatever they want. If there is no objective morality, love is no better than rape. Not in an objective sense. Freedom's no better than slavery. Tolerance is no better than intolerance. If there's one sort of absolute for a social or political liberal, it's tolerance. But of course, if there's no God, why be tolerant? By the way, are Christians called to be tolerant? No, Christians are called to be loving. Tolerance is too weak. Tolerance says, hold your nose and put up with them. Love says, reach out and help them. And sometimes in order to love people, you've got to tell them, don't do what you want to do because you're going to hurt yourself and others. In fact, if you tolerate everything, you're unloving because you're tolerating evil. Religious crusades are not wrong. Christopher Hitchens rightly said, you know, religious people have done evil things in the crusade, to which I responded, you're right, Christopher, but what do you mean by evil? Because if there is no God, there's no such thing as good or evil. It's all a matter of opinion. And of course, you can't complain about the problem of evil. Why not? Well, C.S. Lewis, who was an atheist early in his life, said there can't be a good God out there because there's too much injustice or injustice in the world. Then one day he had an epiphany. He later wrote it in his book, Mere Christianity. Here's what he said. He said, as an atheist, my argument against God was that the universe seems so cruel and unjust, but how would I got this idea of just and unjust? A man does not call a line crooked unless they have some idea of a straight line. What was I comparing this universe with when I called it unjust? You see, there can't be injustice unless there's justice, and there can't be justice unless God exists. You could put it this way, as C.S. Lewis also put it. He said, the shadows prove the sunshine. In order to have shadows, you have to have sunshine. In other words, in order to have evil, you have to have good. Oh, you can have good without evil. You can have sunshine without shadows, but you can't have shadows without sunshine. You can't have evil without good. So if there's something really evil out there, then there has to be something really good. You see, evil doesn't disprove God. Evil may prove there's a devil out there, but it doesn't disprove God because there'd be no such thing as evil unless God existed. Because God is the standard of good, and evil is a lack or a privation in good. Now, we could spend more time on that as well, but we don't have time. We've got to draw some conclusions here. From these three arguments, the cosmological, teleological, and moral arguments, we can draw some conclusions about the first cause. From the cosmological argument, we can see that this being is material, immaterial, timeless, and spaceless. Why? Because he created material time and space, so he can't be made of material time and space. By the way, this answers the who made God objection. Why? If you're timeless, do you have a beginning? No. If you're eternal, you don't have a beginning. You are the uncaused first cause. There has to be an uncaused first cause. It's either the universe or something beyond the universe. All the evidence shows that the universe had a beginning. Therefore, what's beyond the universe is the uncaused first cause. We also know this being is extremely powerful. Why? Because he created out of nothing. Do you know we create out of pre-existing material? God creates out of nothing. Try that. What is nothing? Aristotle had a good definition of nothing. He said, nothing is what rocks dream about. That's nothing. From the teleological argument, we can see that this being is extremely intelligent. He put this world together with precision. He has purpose. We're here for a reason. From the moral argument, we can see he's absolutely morally perfect, and he's also personal. How do we know he's personal from the moral argument? Because you only have a moral obligation to persons. If you walk down the hall here and go try and dunk a basketball, you're not sinning against the law of gravity. You only have obligations to persons, not impersonal forces. We also know that this being is personal from the cosmological argument. You say, how so? Because in order to go from a state of nothingness to a state of creation, someone had to make a choice. and only persons make choices. For example, gravity doesn't make choices. Gravity doesn't decide, look, if Turek drops that remote one more time, I'm not going to pull it to the ground, right? Gravity just does the same thing over and over again. You need to be able to make a choice to go from a state of nothingness to a state of creation. So, we have an immaterial, timeless, spaceless, extremely powerful, extremely intelligent, purposeful, morally perfect, personal creator. This is the God of biblical Christianity identified without reference to the Bible. We haven't even opened the Bible yet, and we have a God consistent with the Bible. Now, does this mean that the Christianity is true? No, not yet, because we don't even know what Jesus, who he was, and if he was God, and if the New Testament is true. We don't know that yet. This is consistent with Christianity, but it's not sufficient to prove Christianity. In fact, there are other theisms out there, right? I mean, maybe Judaism alone is true, or maybe Islam is true, or some other theism. But if God wanted to tell us which theism is true, what could he do? He could do something only he could do, and that would be a miracle. That's point three. Now, again, I've left a lot out, and we're moving on to point three here to see if it's Judaism, Christianity, or Islam as being true. Now, people have a lot of trouble with miracles. For example, they can't believe in Noah. How can you believe in the Noah story? That seems so outlandish. I actually believed it occurred. In fact, I went on a Noah's Ark expedition with a friend of mine who's the real Indiana Jones. His name is Bob Cornuk. In 2006, we went into Iran because we had some intelligence that there might be the remains of an old boat up at about 13,000 feet. I don't have time to give you the whole backstory, but we got in there in an area which could be called Ararat in the Elburz Mountains. At 13,125 feet, we saw this object sticking out of the side of a mountain. We got up to it, and it was rock. It looked like it could have been the side of a boat at one point, though, so we pulled some samples off it. We took it back to the United States, and 5 out of the 9 samples tested as petrified wood. But we can't prove it's Noah's Ark because it didn't say USS Noah on the side. I mean, how could you prove that anyway? You know, we don't know, but it's possible. Also, resurrections. People don't believe in resurrections because everyone they know who's dead is still dead, right? Uncle George is dead. You don't go to the graveyard and say, Uncle George, come forth. It doesn't happen. So they don't believe resurrections occur. And for some reason, the biggest problem miracle in the Bible is Jonah. Is that a tale of a whale or a whale of a tale? What is the deal with Jonah? How can you believe in Jonah? It seems so outlandish. Now, what is the greatest miracle in the Bible? A lot of people say the resurrection. No, the resurrection's an easy miracle compared to the greatest miracle. What is the greatest miracle in the Bible? I mean, the biggest. What's that? Let there be light. Yes, the greatest miracle in the Bible is the first verse. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. If that verse is true, every other verse is at least possible, right? I mean, it's true that the entire space-time continuum leapt into existence out of nothing and God created it. Can he do whatever he wants that's not logically impossible inside the universe? Of course, if he can create the universe out of nothing, can he raise somebody from the dead? Can he do the Noah miracle? Can he do the Jonah? That's easy for God to create the whole universe out of nothing. Now, here's the interesting thing. We actually have scientific evidence that the first verse is true. We just mentioned it briefly before. So if the first verse is true, maybe these other verses are true as well. We'd have to look at the evidence to see if they are. Now, some of you may have just picked on something I said and said, I don't know if I agree with that. You said, God can do whatever he wants. It's not logically impossible. I thought God can do anything. No, there's even some things God can't do. He can't do logically impossible things. Like what? Like he can't create a square circle. No such thing. Can't create a married bachelor. No such thing. Can't create a one-ended stick. No such thing. Can't create an honest politician. Okay? There's some things God can't even do. I hear you have a little park here that you're not too pleased about. I tried to run down there today. I had to go past all sorts of construction. I almost got sucked into a sinkhole. But actually, there's some things that you can do that even God can't do. Like what? You can lie. God can't lie. If he could lie, he wouldn't be God. You can change. He can't change. He's an infinite being, a perfect being. What's he going to change from? Perfection to what? Imperfection? No. There's some things. If he could do those things, he wouldn't be God. Notice, by the way, that Jesus relates two of the most controversial miracles in the Old Testament to his life, Noah and Jonah. Do you think Jesus thought Noah and Jonah were historical or hysterical? He thought they were historical. Look, if God exists, miracles are possible. The greatest miracles already occurred. The question is now, have any other miracles occurred? And for that, we got to move to the New Testament and conclude this. Now, I'm going to give you six lines of evidence that the New Testament writers are telling the truth. We're not going to cover them all. We don't have time. I'm going to list six. We're going to cover two, okay? They all begin with the letter E to help you remember them. We have early testimony. We have eyewitness testimony. We have embarrassing testimony. I'll explain what that means in a minute. We have excruciating testimony. We have expected testimony. And we also have extra biblical testimony. Let me briefly mention early testimony. Most, if not all, the New Testament documents written prior to 70 AD, and the data within those documents goes back even earlier. Eyewitness testimony, just in the book of Acts and John alone, there's over 140 eyewitness details that have been confirmed to be true, either through archaeological or other historical means. All those details, by the way, are listed in chapter 10 of I Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist. By the way, makes a great Christmas gift. Anyway, I'll get to embarrassing testimony, excruciating testimony in a minute. Expected testimony, that deals with Old Testament prophecy. In fact, if I only had one Old Testament prophecy to make my case with, it would be Isaiah chapter 53. You guys know what I'm talking about, Isaiah chapter 53? If you haven't read Isaiah chapter 53, go home and read it tonight. In fact, begin in chapter 52, verse 13, and go to the end of chapter 53. When you read it, you're going to say, wow, this is an uncanny description of the sacrificial atonement that Jesus accomplished for us. Yeah, but it was written 700 years in advance. How do we know it's written in advance? Because the greatest of the Dead Sea Scrolls, the great Isaiah scroll, 24 feet long, was found, including all of Isaiah 53. And we know that particular scroll dates from at least 100 BC. Of course, the original Isaiah is much earlier, but we know this prophecy predated Christ. And of course, extra biblical testimony. There are 10 ancient non-Christian sources within 150 years of Jesus' life that mention Jesus and the apostles briefly. And when you add up their references, you get a story congruent with the New Testament. And by the way, in the book, there's a chapter called The Top 10 Reasons We Know the New Testament Writers Told the Truth. These are just six of them, and we're only going to cover embarrassing and excruciating testimony because we don't have a lot of time. Let's start here at embarrassing testimony. And the principle of embarrassment goes like this. If there's something embarrassing to the author or authors, it's probably true. Why? Why would it be true? Yeah, you're not going to make up embarrassing details about yourself. You know, you want to keep those out. You're certainly not going to make them up. In fact, let me ask you guys a question. How many people in here have ever lied to make yourself look good? Let me see your hands, please. Those of you that don't have your hands up right now are lying to make yourself look good, and we know you're lying. Okay, how many people in here have ever lied to make yourself look bad? You don't lie to make yourself look bad. Why would you do that? That's why we call this embarrassing testimony. We call it the duh factor. Because these people who wrote this down would never say these things if they weren't true. They certainly wouldn't make them up. Notice the New Testament writers depict themselves as dim-witted. They fail to understand what Jesus is saying several times. They travel with the guy for 3 years and they still don't know what his mission is. Also, they are uncaring. They fall asleep on Jesus, not once, but twice. Stay up with me and pray. This is my greatest hour of need. We'll do it, Lord. Don't worry. What do they wind up doing? Not once, but twice. Then they make no effort to give Jesus a proper burial. Who buries Jesus? Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus. Now, who is Joseph? Well, he's a member of the Sanhedrin. Well, what did the Sanhedrin do? They were the Jewish ruling council which sentenced Jesus to die. Why would they make Joseph look like a good guy while they ran away and hid for fear of the Jews? And why would they put Jesus in a Jewish tomb? What could the Jews have done if the Christians began claiming Jesus had risen from the dead, but he was still dead in the Jews' own tomb? What could the Jews have done? They could have gone to their own tomb, taken out the body, and said, "Stop all this nonsense, talk about the resurrection. He's dead. Here's his body." They didn't do that. What'd they say? They said the disciples came and stole the body while the guards were asleep. Now, that's a bad explanation for at least two reasons. Reason number one, if you're a Roman guard on duty and you fall asleep on watch, what happens to you? You're toast. Reason number two, if you're a Roman guard on duty and you fall asleep on watch, how do you know what happened? What happened? Well, we were asleep, see? And then the disciples came and stole the body while we were still sleeping. And that, how do you know that? Stop asking questions and just give us the bribe. You say, well, how do we know this story is even true? It's in the Gospel of Matthew. Well, how do we know Matthew's telling the truth? Because it's not just Matthew who says this. For the first 150 years of early Christianity, the Christians kept saying, Jesus has risen from the dead, and the Jews kept saying, the disciples stole the body while the guards were asleep. Well, now, what does that imply? That the tomb was empty. You don't have to come up with an empty tomb story if he's still in there. The Jews are admitting the tomb is empty, and it's their own tomb. Also, they are rebuked. Peter is called Satan by Jesus. Do you think they made that up? Do you think Peter, who wrote that down, said, hey, Pete, or Mark wrote it down. He said, hey, Pete, I'm going to make this a real interesting story. I'm going to have the Lord call you Satan. What do you think Peter would have said? Have him call you Satan. I mean, I'm the leader here. Why is he calling me Satan? Also, notice Paul rebukes Peter for being wrong about a theological issue. He says, look, I told Peter to his face that he was wrong for trying to get these New Testament believers to obey the Old Testament law. If they're making all this up, why are they arguing over theology in the Bible? Why are two leaders arguing? They're not making it up. That's why. They're just trying to get it right. Also, notice they are cowards. Peter denies Christ three times. Again, he's their leader. After saying, I'll never deny you, Lord, he goes off and does it. And then the disciples run away. This is like a Monty Python movie. Run away. They all run away. And who are the brave ones? They're the women. The women are the brave ones. That's right. Yes, ladies, you can give yourselves a hand. That's right. I am woman, hear me roar. Didn't run away like you sissy pants men did. Now, who wrote this down? Men. Now, what man? He's going to say that he was hiding for fear of the Jews, why the women went down and discovered the empty tomb. Would any man make that up? No man would make that up. I mean, if I were making it up, I'd write something down like this. Let's see, we marched right down there and overpowered that elite Roman guard. Yeah, that sounds good. Then we saw Jesus, who congratulated us on our great faith. And then we went and comforted the trembling women. Certainly wouldn't say we were Mr. Sissy Pants. Why the women went down and discovered the empty tomb. And oh, by the way, why would you never say the women were the first witnesses in that culture? Because a woman's testimony was not considered on par with that of a man. So if you're making up the New Testament story, you'd only have the men be the first witnesses. Yet all four gospels say the women were the first witnesses. Why? Because they really were. They obviously wouldn't have made it up. It's too embarrassing. Actually, one lady came up to me once and she said, I know why Jesus appeared to the women first. I said, why? And she said, because he wanted to get the story out. I said, you know, that is an excellent point. I had not thought of that. I mean, ladies, when your man comes home from work, does he say much? I mean, there could have been a nuclear explosion at his place of work and he wouldn't tell you, right? Imagine Peter, that first resurrection Sunday, he comes home, his wife sees him and says, hey, honey, anything happened at work today? Nah. Same old, same old. What do you mean? I heard Jesus had risen from the dead just like he had predicted. Is it true? Oh, yeah, it is. What do you got to eat around here? See, men don't say much. Also, notice they are doubters. Despite being taught several times that Jesus would rise from the dead, the disciples are doubtful when they hear of his resurrection. And who do they blame it on when they first hear it? That's these emotional women. What do they know? And then, check this out. Some are even doubtful after they see him risen. You see, this is Matthew 28, 17. What happens in Matthew 28, 19? It's the reason there is a Salvation Army. Matthew 28, 19, what is it? That's the Great Commission. Jesus is on the Mount of Olives giving them the Great Commission. Some of his final words where he says, go, therefore, make disciples of all nations. Notice he didn't say make believers. Make disciples of all nations, baptize in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen. And lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. And then he ascends to heaven. And as he's saying this, some are standing there going, you see that guy over there? Yeah. That guy over there is Jesus. Oh no, it can't be Jesus. He was just killed the other day. I'm telling you, it's Jesus. It can't be. He was killed. I saw the spear went in his side. Blood and water came out. I'm telling you, it's Jesus. It can't be Jesus. He was killed. It is. How do you know it's Jesus? The women told me. They're not making this up. There's even potentially embarrassing details about Jesus. He's considered out of his mind by his own family who come to seize him and take him home. You've heard people say, oh, you know, the New Testament writers embellish Jesus to be God. Really? Then why are they putting this kind of stuff in there? Also, he's deserted by many of his followers. In John chapter 6, he says, look, you want to follow me? You must eat my flesh and drink my blood. And some of the disciples said, "Who? This is a hard teaching. We can't follow this guy anymore." Hey, if I was there, I'd say the same thing. Eat your flesh and drink your blood. What are you, a cannibal? I'm not following you either. And who would have made up eat flesh, drink blood? That's not a made up doctrine. Also, he's not believed in by his own brothers. In John chapter 7, his own brothers don't believe in him. Later, we learn, however, that James, the half-brother of Jesus, dies as a martyr in the city of Jerusalem. He's thrown off the Temple Mount by the Sanhedrin. When he hits the ground, they find him still alive, so they bludgeon him to death. How do we know this happened? No New Testament document tells us this. Who tells us this? Josephus, the Jewish historian, who lived from 37 AD to about 90 AD or 100 AD. He was in Jerusalem at the time. He tells us that James, the half-brother of Jesus, dies as a martyr for his brother. But when Jesus was on the earth before the resurrection, James didn't believe his own brother was God. Why is he dying as a martyr later, 30 years later? 1 Corinthians 15 tells us Jesus appeared to James, and that convinced him. But when Jesus was on the earth, James didn't think his own brother was God. Hey, how many people in here have a brother? How many people in here have a brother who thinks he's God? Yeah, you don't believe in him either, right? Neither did James. He's thought to be a deceiver. He turns off Jewish believers to the point that they want to stone him. In John chapter 8, he's talking to Jews who believed in him. He gets to the point in the conversation, he says, look, if you believed in Abraham, you ought to believe in me because I knew Abraham. And they said, you're not even 50 years old. How could you know Abraham? And he said, before Abraham was born, I am. And they immediately picked up stones to stone him. Why? Who's he claiming to be? He's claiming to be Yahweh. What's that a quotation from? I am. That's from Exodus 3:14. You remember when it's the burning bush? Remember when God appeared to Charlton Heston? Moses says to God, who should I tell the Israelites you are? And God says, tell them I am sends you. What does I am mean? I am means the self-existent eternal one. The being that had no beginning will have no end. The being whose essence is his existence. The unmoved mover. That's who Jesus is claiming to be. That's why they picked up stones to stone him. They knew exactly what he was claiming. It amazes me today there are people out there who say Jesus never claimed to be God, like Jehovah's Witnesses. When they come to my door, I go, come on in. You want something to drink? Have a seat. I'll say, they'll get the watchtower material out. I go, oh, before we get to the watchtower, can I just ask you one question? Yeah, sure, go ahead. If Jesus never claimed to be God, then why did they kill him? For saying, love your neighbor? Does that get you killed? Imagine Jesus is doing a sermon. He says, love your neighbor. And there are people in the audience going, did you hear what he said? Yeah, he said, love your neighbor. Oh, we can't tolerate that. You must die. No, I don't think so. You don't get killed for saying, love your neighbor. You get killed for claiming to be God. Why? Because claiming to be God was blasphemy to the Jews and it was sedition to the Romans. In fact, early on in Christianity, the Romans called the Christians atheists. Why? Because they knew they weren't Jews, but they wouldn't bow to Caesar or the Roman gods. So they said, these people must be atheists. But obviously, you wouldn't get killed for skipping around saying, love your neighbor and pray for your enemies. You get killed for claiming to be God. And that's what Jesus did. He's called a madman. He's called a drunkard. He's called demon-possessed. Hey, that's real flattering. He has his feet wiped with the hair of a prostitute, which easily could have been seen as a sexual advance. And oh, by the way, do you notice that in Jesus' bloodline, in his genealogy, in Matthew and Luke, there are two prostitutes in there, Rahab and Tamar. Do you think that Matthew and Luke said, you know what? I think we need to spice up the Messiah's bloodline a little bit. Let's put a couple of prostitutes in there. No, I don't think so. No, by the way, in one of them, they get to Bathsheba, and the writer just says, Uriah's wife. He can't even bear to say the name, but he tells the truth, right? Now, in the bloodline of the Messiah, you've got two prostitutes, an adulterer, and David, who's an adulterer, a liar, and a murderer. They're just telling the truth. You don't find anything like this in Egyptian history. Pharaohs, if any historian for the Pharaoh tried to record anything negative about the Pharaoh, he'd be executed. But both the Old Testament and the New Testament writers just tell the truth, which points out what? We all need a savior. We're all fallen. Also, he's crucified despite the fact that anyone who's hung on a tree is under God's curse. If you're making up a Messiah to the Jews, you don't hang him on a tree. Because according to Deuteronomy, you're under God's curse. He was under God's curse. What curse? The curse of sin that we put him under. But again, if you're making it up, you wouldn't say this. All right, let's talk about excruciating testimony. Now, we get this word excruciating. It means out of the crucifixion. And this is the argument that says that these people who are in a position to save themselves from certain peril and suffering and death could have saved themselves by saying, look, he didn't rise from the dead. But they said, no, he did. And they were brutalized for it. This is a painting of Peter being crucified upside down. They could have saved themselves by just saying, look, it didn't happen. Actually, before we get into that, let's look at the apostles' beliefs and practices before and after the resurrection. Realize that all the early Christians were Jews. The only exception to that was Luke. He was a Gentile, but everybody else is a Jew. So before Jesus shows up, they believe in animal sacrifice. In fact, they've been slaying animals and lambs for hundreds of years. Then suddenly Jesus shows up and they say, no, his sacrifice is enough. We don't need to sacrifice all these lambs because here's the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. All these lambs we've been slaying are just symbols pointing to the true Lamb. They give up the sacrificial system virtually overnight. Before, they believed in a binding law of Moses. Afterwards, they said, you know what? Christ's life has fulfilled the binding law of Moses. Before, they believed in strict monotheism. Afterwards, they believed in a Trinity. Three persons in one divine essence. Yes, the Trinity is hinted at in the Old Testament, but it's much clearer in the New. Before, they believed in the Sabbath. In fact, they thought they could be stoned for not obeying the Sabbath. Afterwards, they're worshiping on Sunday, which is a work day, and they're worshiping that day because that's the day he rose. And Paul writes in Colossians, don't let anyone tell you you have to obey any particular Sabbath day. Christ has fulfilled that already. Before, they believed in a conquering Messiah. Afterwards, they believed in a sacrificial Messiah. Oh, there's a conquering Messiah coming, but that's later. Before, they believed in circumcision. Afterwards, they believed in baptism and communion. Now, why would these pious Jews, who were God's chosen people, at least in their minds, why would they, after having a 2,000-year-old or so relationship with the God of the universe, why would they abandon everything on the left for everything on the right virtually overnight? The only thing I can think of is what psychologists call an impact event. What's an impact event? An impact event is something that's so dramatic, that impacts you so dramatically, that it can cause you to change your perspective dramatically. In fact, some impact events are so vivid that you'll remember everything that was going on about that event, even if it occurred 50 years ago. You might not remember what you had for breakfast this morning, but you'll remember an impact event from 50 years ago if you're that old. In fact, only some of you will be able to answer this question. I'm going to ask it anyway. Where were you November 22nd, 1963? If you can remember where you were and what you were doing, raise your hand and hold it up. The rest of you, look around. You see these people with their hands up? These people are very old. November 22nd, 1963 is my earliest memory. I was 2 years old in 2 days. Yes, I'm 51 years old. I know I don't look a day over 50. In fact, when I hit 50, my wife said, you're gonna live to be 100. I said, how do you know? She said, because you look half dead already. Anyway, I remember standing in the living room and my mother was sitting on an ottoman in front of the TV weeping uncontrollably. Mommy, what's the matter? What's the matter? They killed the president. They killed the president. President Kennedy assassinated that day. I can still see her in my mind right now when she was 26 years old. She's 75 today. But I can see her when she was 26 as if she was sitting right there right now. Impact event. That's almost 50 years ago. Where were you when the second plane hit the tower? You know where you were and what you were doing, right? In fact, I was on the phone. I live in Charlotte, North Carolina. I was on the phone to a pastor in Charlotte, and I had the TV on behind me. I had seen the first tower had been hit, and I'm talking to him, and I said, hey, you got the TV on? He goes, yeah. I go, something's happening in New York. Maybe a Cessna hit the World Trade Tower, and we're just talking back and forth. Suddenly, he screams into the telephone. He goes, another plane just hit the second tower. I turn around. The second tower's on fire. I said, what kind of plane? A Cessna? He goes, no. This was a big plane. This was like a United plane. It was a passenger plane, a jumbo jet. It went right into the tower and exploded. I said, you saw that? He said, yeah, it was on the TV. I just saw it. It just happened. I said, look, I'll call you back. I hung up the phone. For some reason that morning, I had CNN on, the Communist News Network. And I'm not making this up. But the commentator on CNN said this, one has to think there's some sort of navigational error here. I said, navigational error, you doofus. This is the clearest day in the history of the Big Apple. Who do you think's flying these planes? Stevie Wonder? I mean, come on, this is terrorism. I called that pastor the next day. I said, we're going to come to your church and speak about Islam because that's what this is related to. Now, 9/11 was what, 12 years ago now? And everybody who's old enough in here can remember where you were and what you were doing, something about that day, right? But if I asked you where you were on 9/11 of this year, which was less than a month ago, there's nobody here that could tell me. Well, if you were at the memorial, that would be an impact event. Okay, Mr. Smarty Pants. Where were you on September 21st? You can't remember. Why? Because there was no impact event that day. Do you think a resurrection would have been an impact event? Do you think if he really did rise from the dead, they would have remembered everything they were saying and everything they were doing? And they would have remembered everything Jesus was saying and everything Jesus was doing till the day they died? That's the only way I can figure out why they would have abandoned everything on the left for everything on the right virtually overnight. People say, oh, they made it up. Let me ask you a question. What did the New Testament writers have to gain by making up a new religion? Well, first of all, they got excommunicated from the synagogue. Then they got beaten, tortured, and killed. Last time I checked, that was not a list of perks. We're going to start a new religion. We are? Yeah, what's it going to get us? Well, first it'll get us excommunicated, then we'll get beaten, tortured, and killed. Well, sign me up! What a great idea! Why haven't we thought of this before? No, I don't think so. In fact, the New Testament writers had every motive to say the resurrection did not happen, not every motive to say it did. Now, a lot of times I get questions like, well, are there any non-Christian writers that talk about Jesus and the apostles? Yeah, there are a few. I mentioned them earlier. But you know what that question assumes? The question assumes that the people who wrote this down, you can't trust. They're biased. That is, if you think about that for half a minute, that is just silly. Because the people who wrote this down had everything to lose by writing it down, not everything to gain. By writing this down, they got excommunicated, beaten, tortured, and killed. Why would they do that if it wasn't true? It makes no sense at all. These are the people you can trust because they paid for it with their blood. Why would they die for a known lie? You say, wait, Frank, if you're talking about martyrdom, we've got a problem because you were just talking about Islam, and Islam has martyrs. But according to Islam, Surah 4, verse 157, that's the fourth chapter in the Quran, it says Jesus never even died, much less rose from the dead, yet the New Testament documents say he did, yet they both have martyrs. So isn't it kind of a wash here? No, it's not a wash. Why? Well, there's a lot of differences between the Muslim martyrs of today and the New Testament martyrs of New Testament times. Well, let me just give you the main difference here. The Muslim martyrs don't have evidence that Islam is true. They just have faith. But the New Testament writers were in a position to know whether Jesus had risen from the dead. They saw Jesus. They touched Jesus. They ate with Jesus. They verified with their own senses that Jesus had risen from the dead. You see, many people will die for a lie they think is the truth. Nobody will die for a lie they know is a lie. And the New Testament writers were in a position to know whether it was a lie or not, and they went ahead and died for it anyway because they knew it was true. They verified it with their own senses. So, what's the summary? We have early eyewitness, embarrassing, excruciating, expected, and extra-biblical testimony, and there are four more reasons in the book. So the bottom line to the New Testament, it's historically reliable. It's fact, not fiction. If it says Jesus said it, then Jesus really said it. If it says Jesus did it, then Jesus really did it. Now, we're not saying the Bible's inerrant at this point. I think you have to do more work to get to that point. We do so in the book. I'm simply saying it's historically reliable on the big issues. And if Jesus rose from the dead, mark it down, Christianity's true. So, what's the overall argument? Does truth exist? Does God exist? Are miracles possible? Well, the greatest one's already occurred. Of course it's possible. Is the New Testament true? That's just what we went through a minute ago. We'll get to your questions here in a minute. For more, however, the book and the DVD are available out there. Don't forget about our app. In fact, there's a quick answer section on the app. What's the quick answer section? Suppose you're in a conversation with somebody and they say something about Christianity and you don't know how to deal with it. You take out your iPhone or your Droid, you click on the quick answer section of the Cross-Examine app, and chances are there's an answer to that question right there. And it's got all of our podcasts and blogs and events on there, so check that out. Also, and it's free too, we have an email. We'll send you one email a month that'll have a little article there that will help you. If you want to sign up for it, there's this bookmark on the table, and you just fill out this little card, and you get to keep the bookmark, and we don't give your email address to anyone else. We're also on YouTube, Twitter, and Facebook, as everyone is, and by the way, we are so into social media that we've combined YouTube, Twitter, and Facebook into one platform. We call it YouTwitface. Okay? Don't forget we're on radio and we're also on TV. In fact, we'll be on TV tonight when you get home. So the bottom line here, it's true. The question now is, so what? And in order, we're going to get to your questions here in about 4 minutes. Just hang on. In order to answer that question, we've got to ask the question, why did Jesus come? He actually tells us why he came. What does he say? For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. A ransom? Many people are thinking, a ransom? Look, I don't need anybody to pay God a ransom to get me off the hook. I'm a pretty good person, right? God doesn't need to have a ransom paid to him. I can make it to God on my own because I'm a pretty good person. You know why we think that? Because we have a relative moral standard in our mind. From the moral giant Mother Teresa, the Catholic nun for her most of her adult life helped the poor in India, down to the moral midget Hitler. And next to Hitler, we put criminals. We know they're bad, they're just not quite as bad as Hitler. And then next to criminals, we put all the immoral people that we all know. You know, our immoral friends and relatives who aren't quite as good as we are, because our picture's right here next to Mother Teresa. And then if we believe in heaven and hell at all, we arbitrarily draw a line in the sand and we say, these are the bad people, they're going to hell, and we're the good people, we're going to heaven. Now, the problem with this is that the moral standard does not run up and down between people. We shouldn't be comparing ourselves to other people. In fact, Paul even says that in 2 Corinthians 10. He says, why are you comparing yourself to other people? He says, the moral standard does not run up and down. The moral standard is God's perfect moral standard, and it runs across the top, and all of us have fallen short of that standard. And what Christ has done is he's come and lived the perfect life in our place. And when you trust in Christ, you're not just forgiven for what you've done, you're given Christ's righteousness. Think about that. Your sins are wiped away, and then you're given the righteousness of Christ. So when God sees you judicially, he sees Christ. That's amazing. However, this was accomplished at a great price. It wasn't easy. And this was illustrated, I think, beautifully by Third Day with cuts from the Passion. Brace yourself. The purpose of his life was to be punished in your place. His life was a gift to you. Have you received his gift? If not, why not? It's free. And if you have, does anyone know it? Or are you an undercover Christian? If they were to drag you into a courtroom like they do in Pakistan, and try and convict you of being a Christian, would you be convicted or would you be acquitted? Well, there's not enough evidence here. Why don't you let this person go? If you'd be acquitted, you may want to reconsider how you've been living. The least we can do for him after what he's gone through for us, and by the way, this was not the worst of it. The worst of it was being judicially forsaken by the Father. But the least we can do is to let other people know we stand with him. We're his ambassadors, as imperfect as we are. Paul says God makes his appeal through you. That's the least we can do. Have you done that? Are you doing that? If not, why not? What is the purpose of your life? This is not a glorified Monopoly game. Purpose of your life is the same purpose for which Harvard University began. Yeah, they all started with Bible verses. Harvard University began on John 17:3. Let every student be plainly instructed and earnestly pressed to consider well the main end of his life and studies is to know God and Jesus Christ, which is eternal life. That's the purpose of life, to know God and to make him known. And your mind is built for that. Are you using it for that? Harvard's early motto was truth for Christ and the church. They've fallen away, but we don't have to. That's one great thing about the Salvation Army. You guys are rock steady through the generations.